See if you hear Dan, he is speaking through this song. How many of you know this song, Cold, Cold Heart? How many of you heard Dan speaking through this song? If you know the words, it's like pretty incredible how much songs and the, that's a Hank Williams song, and you know, country and western prides itself in being storytellers, and that's a story, and it's a poignant story, and it really speaks to our children and the work that parents have to do to heal the hurts from a long time ago and melt that cold, cold heart and get in there. So yes, Ken is gracious to introduce me and to have invited me here. I'm thrilled to be here. As I said to one of the new staff during lunch today, I'm not sure that she's here, but she's been here for a week. And I said, gosh, I have a longer association with Calo than you do, but I've never been here before. So having known Ken for a long time, but also having heard about Calo when I ran a clinic in Pennsylvania for 10 years, we referred a number of children here, and we also worked with children who had come, who had been here, and then they came home to South Central Pennsylvania, and we helped them reintegrate using what they had learned here and building on everything that they experienced here, which was pretty awesome how they came home. At one point, I would have been very intimidated speaking after Dan. Now, I'm really excited because Dan was talking all about the brain stuff that we're going to be talking about this afternoon. Hour and a half is like this much time to talk about this much information and exciting things, but I'm thrilled for the opportunity. So the really quick story of Lark is mother first, most important to me, most precious to me, but I've been a school librarian, that was one of my first careers, school principal for 10 years, elementary school, school psychologist. Each time I was trying to figure out more of what was going on in these little busy brains, and then finally decided, you know, I really don't get it yet. So I'm going to go back to school, and my doctorate is in clinical psychology, but specializing in early trauma. About the time I went back to school, as what do they call us, NTS, non-traditional students, right, the brain research was beginning to come out, and it was thrilling because what it was telling us was, yes, you're on the right track, yes, the brains do become changed, these little developing brains do get skewed, and we have to figure out how to unskew them or how to get them back to a healthy situation, a healthy condition, or as in the cases of some people with strokes, we have to find a way to compensate by using another part of the brain. And that's what we're learning about in terms of the attachment piece in the brain. And I want to emphasize that this afternoon, even in the short period we have, this is going to be interactive. So, oh, please don't groan. I won't make you stand up and do something in front of the group, I promise. Unless you want to, you know, maybe. We're going to be practicing what we're talking about. So we're talking a lot about self-regulation. We're going to practice it. If you don't want to practice it, at least be quiet so you don't interrupt others who do want to practice. Okay, is that a deal? Because I know, I've been in the audience before, end of the day. Sometimes it's like, no, I'm not doing what this silly woman wants me to do. I'm just going to check my email while she's doing that. And that's fine as long as it doesn't go off. Your phone, but what I really need us to do is to practice some of the things that Dan was talking about this morning. I've known Dan for years. I love his work. We're incredibly fortunate to have him in the field. We're now looking at a bigger picture this afternoon, and he'll probably go into some of that more tomorrow, but I'm glad he did the neurology part so I don't have to. Even though I love it, I don't have to go into it today. So we're going to be talking about and practicing self-regulation. And I want to mention that I love the stories that Dan tells because they really do bring it home. They tell us specifically what it is that we're talking about. So when I say self-regulation, what does that really mean? And I was surprised a couple years ago when I asked at the end of a talk similar to this, okay, so does everybody get it what we're talking about, self-regulation? And somebody raised their hand and said, so I'm not sure. What is it really? And I thought, oh, shucks, I've missed it. But we need to understand it in a way that we can help our children, the children with whom we work or parent, to understand it in their little bodies, and that's what's so difficult for them. So during this hour and a half, we're going to have times when I ask everybody to just stop. And then to take a deep breath. And then, as Dan was saying, we feel it in our guts. We also can then refresh our brains. We're doing our reading, learning fabulous brain studies, research on what happens when we reoxygenate our brain, not when we're running from a train, not when we're trying to not get killed, but when we're just trying to refocus, re-energize ourselves. Deep breathing is something we always emphasize in therapy, but it doesn't always happen because we forget about it. But we need to do it. Here's another one. The studies are not all out yet, but I'm going to tell you that I truly believe that when you stop and take a drink of water, and we used to just keep cases of those little bottles, I know they're terrible for the environment. They're awful. I don't know what else we could do, but to keep those little bottles of water, because hydrogenating our bodies, hydrating our bodies, oxygenating our bodies, calming our bodies are all things that are incredibly important when we're doing the very hard work of helping our brains to relearn what they learned badly in the beginning. So keep those in mind for the time that we have together. And let's look at the slides that we handed out. We're going to do them in a little bit different order because we're fortunate today that we have an art therapist who's going to join me in explaining a little bit more about art therapy. So there are many pathways to the brain. There are many ways to healing, and we're going to talk about three of them this afternoon. One of them is art, particular kind of art therapy. Another is music therapy. And just as Dan said earlier today, when we laugh together, we become communal. And the same is true for music. When we hear music together, we become communal. And a third way is just the physical interventions that we do, the things that we do together physically, help us to be in communion with each other. And that helps us to feel comfortable with each other, and it also helps us to feel one of my favorite words in the whole universe, which is safe. So if you're feeling safe with me, you're going to relax and listen to what we're talking about or think more about what we're talking about rather than using your energy to try and keep yourself safe. So we're going to talk about those three things this afternoon. Very practically, this presentation will offer two ways to practice those creative arts to impact brain function. We're going to practice at least two body movements that improve healthy brain function and self-regulation. And one of those, of course, is the deep breathing, and another is drinking water, but we'll talk about a few more. No, we'll practice a few more. The expansion of resources from which to draw. I have a sheet, and I'm not sure that it came with your handout, so we'll have to check and see if it's not here. Oh, it is in your packet. Last page, yes. Yes. Is there a page at the end of your packet that has my heading on the top? Okay, so there are some resources. I'm going to add two of them. I'd like you to do it right now, if you would. Last page? Some of us don't. Okay, flip it over, write these two, and then maybe we can ask Robin if we can get more of that last page. I just brought it to her today, which may be why you guys didn't get it. The two that I'm going to ask you to add are, one is called acestudy.org. It's a website. How many of you know it? Acestudy.org. It's exactly what Dan was talking about earlier, that our bodies actually physiologically change as we get older when we have early trauma. And this is a brilliant study by Rob Anda and Vince Folletti of the Centers for Disease Control with 17,000 adults, middle and upper class adults, looking retrospectively at their current medical conditions and their history, and finding this gigantic connection between physical illness in middle and later age that is not accounted for in other ways. For example, if you have lung disease, there's no one else in your family that has lung disease, and you didn't live near a coal mine, you're not a smoker, etc., but you had early trauma of one of the nine types that they had listed. And they're making these huge correlations that just say, wow, our bodies are so much more vulnerable, which is the other great word that I love. It's the V word, and I use it in therapy a lot, but you know, the kids get used to hearing it. Okay, what's going on here? And they go, I'm feeling very vulnerable. When they get brave enough to be able to say that, I know we're in a good place. Our bodies also are vulnerable when we are growing up with the effects of trauma. So I want you to add that one, and the other one I will come to. I guess I don't have it right here. So I'll let you know what that other one was. It was while Dan was speaking that I thought, oh, yeah, they really need to know about this one. Oh, theraplay.org. Theraplay.org. Make sure you're not getting a sensory integration clinic in Pennsylvania. This is the center in Evanston, right outside of Chicago, Theraplay Institute. All right, and we're going to talk about one in particular, one very new but brilliant therapeutic technique to reduce the effects of trauma. That is an art and narrative-centered therapy, and I just can't say enough about it. Although with our children, so often their traumas were so pervasive, they're so big and they're of so many different types, that you have to do this a number of times, and it's sort of like EMDR for those of you who are familiar with it. You kind of keep going back and keep going back, and eventually you get to the core issues. All right, so I'd like you, before we talk about art therapy, I would like you just for a minute to take that deep breath, take a minute to be still, but think about what you would like to be able to walk out of this room and say, good, I've accomplished these two things. That's kind of cool. All right, now we're going to have a state change, because this is what we're talking about the whole afternoon. You were just very quiet and calm and focused and thinking about it. Now I need you to change your state and keep them up in the air. This is what we're talking about when we talk about state change. Everybody know what we're talking about here? We are being calm one moment. Now we're being what? Alert? Ready? Whoa. Sort of. Okay, so we're seriously practicing what we're talking about. One of the reasons that I brought balloons, that I always bring balloons, is that in a therapy session, nice save, thank you. Okay, pass them up. Next person who hits it, catches it, please. Ready? One, two, three. Thank you very much. One of the things that we do in therapy is if a child becomes stuck, which our kids do on a regular basis, we have to change their state. Talking to them doesn't do it. We know that. So how do we change their state? We ask them to do something like, I'll throw a pillow at them. They're going to catch it almost always. If a child doesn't catch a pillow, if you throw it at them, you've got some serious issues that you really need to address with their, probably with their medical provider. Because that's an instinct. It's something that you do to protect yourself. If you can't do that, there's something really, really serious going on, more than the seriousness of what we're already talking about. But try and change state with children when they get stuck, or with teenagers especially. And they'll pretend they don't care, and then they'll hit the balloon, and then you often end up laughing or giggling or something like that, which is a really good thing. All right, so I love that picture. So cool. Something that we've been discussing, I had the opportunity to talk with a number of people at Calo staff today, which was really a thrill for me. This is such a great place. And the people who work here are totally, I mean, it's very clear they're very dedicated to what they're doing. So to hear their success stories and how they're making it work is very thrilling for me. But something that we talked about was the more recent understanding of how much sensory issues play a part in inhibiting healing. And I want to give you a very practical example. First of all, in our clinic, we did a random study of 25 children who came in for assessments, and we did a sensory profile with them. Those were children who had an RAD diagnosis, a PTSD diagnosis, or one of the attendant diagnoses, and they were considered, our clinic was really for severe children. So we did this SI sensory integration profile, and we found that 75% of the children with this diagnosis also had a sensory problem. That's a very high number. Now, they didn't have necessarily across-the-board problems with all of their senses. And, you know, I used to say five. We used to think five. There are really eight senses, and that includes understanding where you are in space, understanding how your insides are at equilibrium or not. But it makes a huge difference when you're working with children who have meltdowns a lot of times, and they don't know why, and you don't know why, and you can't figure out an antecedent. You don't know what the trigger is. And it could be that there are some of you in this room right now ready to have a meltdown. You want to put your head down on the desk, or you want to leave, or you want to cover your ears. Well, it's the end of a long day. A lot of children with sensory issues, by the end of the day, they're just overloaded, and they can't handle even regular interaction or being in the room with someone. So when do we often see children in therapy? Yeah. So we need to be aware of that, and there are things to do. And very luckily, sensory integration is something that is treatable. You can work with it pretty easily. We hired an occupational therapist to be on our staff. If I said that before, I apologize. But the reason is because we wanted that OT to be able to come into the room with us when we were seeing that there were problems and give us hands-on tools right on the spot, and it worked really beautifully. We also know that for many of these children, talk therapy is the least responsive way of getting to them. But anybody in the front row have trouble with touch? It's okay if you do. No? Okay, because I tend to to give examples while we're talking. So one of the things with children with sensory issues is that very often light touch is very aversive to them. It almost hurts, and they'll tell you that. It's like, oh, don't do that, or they'll pull away. It may not be because they don't want you to touch them. It may be because they are either tactically defensive and they don't want anyone to touch them, or it could be that we're just not doing it right. So instead, if you squeeze or put a more firm pressure, and we do have research that supports why this is true, but because of shortness of time, I'm not going to go into all that. A firm touch feels anchoring. It gets down to the muscle and it tells them, okay, you're safe here, you're okay, this relationship is good, or at least right now this relationship is good and you can relax. So that's a really good thing to know, those kinds of things. Early trauma affects the nonverbal part of the brain. If I broke my arm, I would not expect the orthopedic guy to put a cast on my leg. But when we're using cognitive behavioral therapy before children have had enough healing to get to the place where they can take advantage of it, that's what we're doing. We're putting a cast on a leg when it belongs on the arm. We need to go back to the site of the injury, which for most of our children is preverbal or in the very early stages, before they understand what's going on. So the injuries are happening when they cannot make sense of it. And someone said that earlier, that we're talking about narrative. People try and make a narrative of their lives. Oh, another resource is a very excellent book called Connecting with Kids Through Stories. And it's a simple way of helping a child develop a coherent narrative, which we all need. Really almost scary research that's out about the high correlation between how well a parent's narrative is coherent, meaning it makes sense. It's okay, it makes sense. It doesn't have to be a beautiful story. It just has to make sense to the parent. Very high correlation between that being high and a child's narrative being high, or the opposite. So if a parent doesn't make sense of their own life, doesn't have a coherent narrative, very high chance that the child will not. And without a coherent narrative, it's pretty hard to have good attachment because you don't really understand what relationships are about. But I do have a little story to tell you about a little girl whose mom brought her in when she was 5 or almost 6. And she said, I don't know what's going on, but my child just went to kindergarten and she keeps coming home with the same drawing. And the drawing is of a kind of a stick figure guy, and he has a rake. And he has a very mean look. It's a very menacing look. It's a very frightening picture. And I asked the mom, if she had any idea where this could be coming from, and she said, no. And I met with her, and I met with the child, and we were not getting anywhere for a couple of sessions until one time when the child was describing her picture, she used some word that triggered the mom, and the mom pulled me aside and said, and she was white as a sheet. She said, I can't believe this. And I said, well, what is it that you're thinking is going on? She said, when my daughter was 8 months old, we lived with the child's father in a different state, and the father was abusive. The father was coming at me with a rake. But it was in the other room, and she couldn't have seen it. I don't believe she could have seen it. She was in her crib in the living room, and we were in the kitchen. Well, you better believe that somehow this child saw it and internalized it. And she wasn't able to remember it. She couldn't tell the words about it. But as Dan was saying earlier, we live what we learn. We live what we experience. And what she experienced was that people with rakes are dangerous. And the mom said, I don't know how she could remember that. I picked her up. As soon as I pushed this guy away, I picked her up. We ran out of the house. We got in the car. We never went back, and we never saw him again. And I've never talked about it with anyone. So the power of being able to draw on this side of the brain, the nonverbal, is extremely profound. I want to tell you about, and if you turn to page 3 in your handouts, she did them individually, didn't she? Each slide, wow. It's at the top of it, the top of the slide says art therapy for trauma. It's about halfway through, I think. A little more than halfway. All right, we're going to talk about this particular trauma art narrative therapy. Everybody find it? Therapy for art trauma at the top. Okay. We're practicing what we preach. Everybody stand up for a minute. And this is Mother May I. Ready? Would you please tell us to do something, and we all have to say Mother May I before we do it?
Would you please touch your top of your head?
Mother May I? Yes, we may. Okay, you want to give us one more? Yes.
Put your hands together.
Mother, may I? Father, may I? Okay, let's sit down. We're in communion here. We're doing something together, and we're changing our state. All right, I saw a couple people yawn. We'll see how many more yawn after we sit down. All right, so now we're looking at a particular kind of therapy, which is called, I'm just going to move us up here, to trauma art narrative therapy. And the woman who developed this is a brilliant psychiatrist named Lyndra Bills. And I've known Lyndra for a long time. She's just really amazing. By the way, how many of you know the sanctuary model? Sanctuary model? Lyndra was one of the original people involved in developing the sanctuary model. This is what Lyndra said when we were talking to her about, or learning from her about how this works. If I'm going to ask you to tell me the most traumatic thing that ever happened in your life, and you don't know me, how are you going to feel? Uncomfortable, a little bit vulnerable? If I ask you first to tell me about a time when you feel safe, and you put yourself in the state of feeling safe with me, and we experience it together, how much do you think that will go towards helping you to be able to share with me something that otherwise could be a very vulnerable-making thing? It's going to make a difference, isn't it? Before you leave the office, how important is it going to be for you to share with me a time when you felt safe so that you could again go back to that state of feeling safe? So this is what Lyndra did. And if you want to do this on the back of your paper, you can do it as we're talking. You don't have to. You can just hear it and then try it sometime. But I would suggest that you try this with someone you know, someone who trusts you, so that you actually can go through the whole thing together before you try it with a child or a teenager or a client. I want you to think of a not too terrible, I don't want anybody to melt down in here, so we're going to try this with a really simple kind of thing. And for me, it was a traumatic event that was not so horrible that it changed my life. But when I was in junior high and I was at the dance, one of the counselors started walking towards me, and I thought, oh my gosh, am I in trouble? I was such a, I don't know, we used to call it Susie Doobie, you know. I never wanted to do anything wrong. I thought if I swore, the ceiling would fall in on me or whatever. So this guy's walking towards me, and I thought, what did I do? And he walks up to me, and he whispers in my ear, you may want to go to the ladies' room. And I thought, oh, dear, what in the world? And he looked down, and as I looked down, then I could see that my slip was hanging down longer than my skirt. Now, really. I was 12, I guess, 11 or 12. It was horrifying for me. I was so embarrassed. I was so embarrassed that I actually pulled it down right there and stepped out of it and stuffed it in my skirt because I didn't want to walk across the room with my slip hanging out. It took me until I was an adult graduate student learning about EMDR before I could think about that event and not cringe, not really just go, you know, horrible inside, feel so bad. So I want you to think about something like that. That when, as we look back on it, it's like, what in the world was so awful about this? Everybody got one? Oh, yeah. Okay. Now, I want you to do this very thoughtfully. We're not going to take tons of time because we don't have tons of time. But this is, you will understand this by going through the 5 steps of trauma, art, narrative therapy. There's the event. You're going to back to the last moment you can remember before that event happened when you still felt safe. Nothing was going on. Everything was good. You were feeling okay about it. For me, it was when I was walking up to the dance floor and we were doing the twist, I guess, probably. Yeah, that's how old I am. So I'm getting up there, you know, and I'm feeling safe. And I can remember that, feeling like I was having a good time. All right, so you remember that. Now I want you in your mind just to take a minute and describe that experience as in as much detail as you can. The child is going to draw a picture of themselves being safe, and then you are going to describe for them how they felt, what they remember about that feeling of being safe before the event happened. So you're feeling that, you're remembering that, you can put the words to it. Okay, now I want you to jump forward to after the event. When it's all over, it's done, and you're now again safe. Draw the picture in your head or on your paper. And then you're going to tell me, as the therapist, you're going to tell me the words, and I'm going to write them down underneath the picture. These are the bookends of the traumatic event. This is when you felt safe before. This is when you felt safe afterwards. Now, you can understand just from the very beginning of this why it's a little more difficult with the population with whom we work. Because there may be a time, they may not have a time that they can tell you they really felt safe. So you may have to go through some other therapies first, like EMDR. And I am going to mention neurofeedback, EEG biofeedback right now. It is a brilliant, underused, very important type of therapy that I will not practice again without. We incorporated it into our clinic. It was an integral part of our therapy because it helps us to, especially when we're, as Dan Siegel says, you know, there are the two ends of the spectrum of how our brains function. One is very rigid and the other is chaotic. and the rigid kids are the, you know, OCD kids, and the chaotic kids are the more ADHD type kids. And we want to be somewhere in the middle, but we need to learn how to change state. We have to change our state, and that's very hard for some of our kids. But once we get to that place where they can change state, we're going to ask them to describe before when they felt safe, after when they felt safe. Then we're going to go to number two, which is, at what point did you know that there was a problem? The thing had not happened yet, but you knew something bad was coming. And for me, that would be when the counselor started walking across the room where we had our dance, the gym, and I could see he was looking at me, and so he was coming towards me, and that was the moment when I was like, uh-oh, something's wrong. It's the uh-oh moment. And so we'll ask the child to draw that picture, and then underneath to describe it. They'll tell us, and we'll write it down. That's number two. Number four is the picture that they can describe for us when they knew after the event, you know what? It's going to be okay. I know that this is going to be okay. It isn't okay yet, but we have the sense that we know it's going to be okay. So for me, that was when I looked down, okay, I saw the slip was, I stepped out of it. I made the decision I was going to step out of it. So for me, that was the moment when I made a decision about it. I knew what I was going to do, and so I knew that this very embarrassing event was going to be over soon. So the child draws it. They tell you as much detail as they can about it. I was standing here. I was looking there. I wore this. This person was here. It was this time of day. This was the music that was playing. Whatever they can tell you about it. By describing it in that way, they're putting themselves back in that situation. And that's what we're talking about when we talk about healing the place that's broken. They're actually putting themselves in their brain back to that place. Wasn't that good? I don't know. I see Ken laughing. What are you? You're remembering the old girlfriend and the horse story, right? And that's making you embarrassed. Ken told me that was just made up. Is that really made up? Was that really made up? No. Oh, we need to hear this story. Yes.
With the example you gave about the little girl that drew the picture.
Yes. She didn't. She never did talk about it. She never remembered it on a conscious level that she could talk about.
Was it shared with her?
No.
I mean, later on?
Oh.
The mom realized it?
The mom did talk with her about what happened, why they left her dad, why she never met her dad. And she did explain that her dad hurt her. But she didn't try and confront her with the fact that he used a rake and that's why she drew the picture, because she wanted the child to come up with her own healing or processing of that memory, if you will. It's not the same memory that we talk about, right? So nonetheless, or she wouldn't have drawn the rake and this menacing person.
When did she likely interpret that experience as bad? At 8 months or?
Sure. And partly that's because of what Dan was talking about. When the parent experiences an emotion, they basically download it into the child's developing brain. So what that child was, what the mother was experiencing was terror. So what the child experienced was terror. So she paired the two. The child paired the two. Man with the rake, terror. Isn't it? I mean, there's so much we still have to learn. Uh-huh.
What if the child hasn't got or is stuck in a place where they can't sense it's going to be okay?
And those are the children that we are working with very often. So that's why I said we sometimes have to go through a lot of other therapy before we get to the stage where this is a good therapy to use, but it's quick when it works. It's very quick. It's amazing. Sort of like an EMDR situation. I use that example, but I'm sure most of you must know EMDR, right? Eye movement desensitization and reprocessing. Yeah. Tell you what, hold on to that, and let me finish this fifth picture, and then, okay. So now we're in the middle of the five. This is number three, and this is the actual event. Before we ask this child, as I was mentioning before, you know, you don't walk into a room and say, tell me about the most terrifying thing you've ever experienced. Now they have a safe place that they've been, they have a safe place they're going to, they've already told you about it, they've experienced it again. And the thing that they are now experiencing is, and if I don't know how to use that little pointer thing, so I'm just going to do this, is when we start out with a state of safety, and then we go up to a state of anxiety, and then we come down again. This is self-regulation, and this is what we teach children to do, and most of the kids we work with have not learned to do it. So that's an indication that a child is ready, is when they can self-regulate to the extent that you don't have them going off the deep end when you talk about something scary. All right, so there's a very concrete guide for you. But so now we're at the point where I say to them, okay, would you please draw a picture of the event? I may not even know what it is yet. But they're going to draw this event. And then after drawing it, they're going to tell me what to write. As Cheryl was saying, we're working with a different part of the brain. Once you draw it, you're pulling something else out of your brain, you're going to a different place that may not have been accessible in any other way, and certainly was not ready to just spew out the words. But we want to get this out. We want kids to talk about it. We want them to understand it if it's appropriate. And, you know, I haven't seen that child since she was six, so I don't know whether her mother then went back and really did process that with her. I'm kind of hoping she did, when she was old enough to understand. But these five steps then are a way to help get to number three, to the one in the middle, and still keep it safe, but process it from a whole different place in the brain that allows the child to be able to process as they're telling the story. They make a coherent narrative out of it. There are like 1,000 reasons why this is a really good therapy to use when the child is ready. Yes?
I was going to say that you use so much of this. Unfortunately, not everybody was trained enough to do it.
Yeah.
After Hurricane Katrina.
Uh-huh.
We went into the shelters and were doing this with children.
Mm-hmm.
Some were trained and some weren't trained.
Yes.
Who were going to do it. But
yeah.
It was
yeah.
the only effective way they were able to work with some of those children.
Well, yes. I mean, to think about, I worked with kids I spent almost a year in Croatia after the war in the former Yugoslavia over there, and some of these children saw things that I just can't imagine how they were still alive. Why didn't they just kill themselves? To see the horrors that they had experienced. The only way we could help them was to make sure that they were in a place of safety and that they could self-regulate. Now, how do we teach self-regulation with most of our children when they're young? How many of you are dads in here? How many of the men are dads? Okay, you do something that most... What do you do with your children that scares the heck out of your wives? And you have to take it?
You know that, no, I don't.
I think you have to dance to that.
Well,
I like the music.
Because this is a very close friend who has cerebral palsy. We might be having some.
How about letting us know? Do you want to take it? How about
three babies under three, one of which had
CP.
Cerebral palsy, and the third one she thought for a while might be hypersensitive.
These are they are triplets.
No, three different babies.
Under three.
There's no self-regulation there.
How about we give them a boost? Let's all think about these three children for a minute, and the mom and dad, right? And send them a little white light and just say, whew, healing, healing. Well, thank God for her children's sake. Right. All right. So, yes. What do? You what? Oh, you look to your wives to help you out. I like that man. There's a good guy over there. You throw your babies up in the air, and most of us go, and what do babies' faces do? And then what do they do when you catch them? What do dads always do? What do they always do? I have to watch my mic here. put their babies right there, which is where your heart is, which is what we want babies to do, is to hear their dad's heartbeat. That's very comforting. It's very regulating. We teach self-regulation from the outside. We regulate from the outside so that we learn internally how to do that. If you don't have a dad or a mom who can do that, or who does do that, or who does it in a sadistic way, which, you know, every once in a while we see, it's very hard. And I don't mean specifically throwing babies up, but I mean that experience of making children feel a little anxious and then helping them to calm down. Over and over and over again, as many times as we do that, we externally teach self-regulation so that they can internally learn it. So when I get up here to speak, I'm always a little nervous because you never know how you're going to do, and you know you're a good audience, but you guys are pretty sophisticated, you're educated, you're already in the field, so I'm anxious. And then when we start talking about it, I feel more comfortable because I know this stuff, and then I take a deep breath, and then it's easier for me to share it with you. But that's learned. We're not born that way. So what happens to most of the children that we work with? They get up, but then they don't come down. They don't know how to bring themselves down. And these are the kids who have what Dan referred to this morning or this afternoon, and I call kick the dog syndrome. It's their adrenaline is elevated. It's not elevated to the point that they're sociopathic. Because once you get to a certain level, it drops off and you don't see adrenaline in their system. They don't get nervous about stuff anymore, which is partly, it goes with the empathy piece that's missing. So when they shoot somebody, you don't see the kind of, I can't believe I just did that, or what if I get caught, or I have to make amends, or I have to call the paramedics or something. But the kick the dog syndrome is, if you're up here, if you are living in beta, remember your high school or college chemistry or biology, if you're living in the beta state, when you come down to alpha, which is where most of us are right now, a couple thetas, I see a few people closing their eyes, but most of us are in alpha state, that's uncomfortable. It doesn't feel good because it's not our natural state. So we have to do something to get ourselves back up to that beta state, that anxious state. So we pick a fight or we kick the dog. Here, I guess they wouldn't do that. Ooh, what would happen if you saw one of the kids? I won't ask. We won't say it never happened, but we'll say we don't want it to happen, right? So these are kind of the some of the elements of this trauma processing. They say that the child needs to know that they will be safe, that they are safe. They need to understand that this won't happen again, or if it does, that they can handle it. These are some of the things that you talk about ahead of time. They need to feel the relief of it being over. They need to learn what one of your staff guys was talking about this morning that I thought sounded so beautiful, that they can ask for help and receive it, and it's not going to be dangerous. You were talking about that this morning with the, what did you call it? It's not, what was she doing? It wasn't water skiing. Wake? I'll have to try that. You go up on the wake on a what? On a board? That's amazing, isn't it? I got to try that. I do. Okay. And then the narrative part is so that they can understand what happened. It's a narrative, and it teaches them how to do narrative work, how to understand narrative work, and to feel comfortable with narrative work. Now, you know, this is one way of doing it. You can also act it out. You can draw it out. You can sing it. But a lot of that has to happen before you can just come out and tell it. And the sense of control and confidence, I can do it. I can talk about this and I'm still going to be safe. I'm still going to be okay. In fact, I'm going to be better than I was before. So pretty powerful. So I had in here that we were going to try it, but because of time, we're not going to each try this. But I would suggest that you try it at home. That's like one of those ads, right? Do not try this at home. I do want you to try this at home. I want you to try it with something that's not terribly traumatic, so that you can see how it works for you and make sure that you're comfortable with it. Yes?
I'm going to ask
Yeah, we were just talking about that. That one of the ways is if you can self-control. If you can calm yourself down without going through a total meltdown to calm down, then... Because even if it doesn't work, if you can self-control and self-regulate, then you're going to say, you know what, I don't really like that therapy, it doesn't work for me, but you're not going to re-traumatize yourself. But, and that's another reason that I say, do it when... You know, when it's not such a huge trauma that you're going to be left with that awful feeling if it doesn't work real well. But I've seen it work tremendously well. It's just a beautiful type of therapy. And I think these kinds of therapy, integrate them into regular therapy more often, especially in a relationship, as Cheryl was talking about, when you're teaching, you're modeling relationship for them. You're helping them find that safe, that circle of security, that safe place within this relationship. And then you're giving them the tools to be able to practice it with you. You're enhancing their understanding of good relationship. Somebody had a hand up. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. So it's not just an event. It could be neglect or drug abuse, seeing someone murdered, all these things together.
Right.
How would you do something like that?
Right.
Not
and that's why I said with our children, you need to get to a different place before this will be effective for you. But one thing that you could do is to teach them how to process. Can you see how this, going through this experience with something that is discrete? Like, for example, I worked with a child who was at this point, teenager, she was maybe... She has to go through it because you've all met this girl. You know, everyone in this room knows this girl, and it's pretty horrible. But she could remember and was able to relate through this process one time when she was called to the principal's office and she knew that her foster family was going to be giving her up. She was able to anticipate, because of what was going on at home, that her foster family was probably at that moment packing up her stuff in a paper bag, and it would be her plastic bag, and it would be on the porch when they got there. She practiced with that want. She didn't like the foster family, so for her, it was not as traumatic as it would have been for a lot of kids. But she was able to practice what it means to process a traumatic event. And the practicing of it helped her brain learn how to do it so that as we got into more difficult areas, and none of these therapies are standalone. I always believe that they are in the context of relationship, attachment, and neurological, really, therapy. But this gave her a tool that her brain began to learn to help understand how to process this stuff. So that's how I would use it. I would use the smaller traumas, the little t traumas, or traumas that she was able to talk about, to practice it so that eventually she could get to the big stuff. Does that answer your question? Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, one of the things that I'm curious about is with post-traumatic stress disorder, they're safe. Something happens, the trauma happens, and then life changes, their perspective of life may change after mm-hmm. that. And so their sense of a feeling safe afterwards mm-hmm. may be pretty distorted, and they don't feel real safe. How do you address it with a child that doesn't have that?
Because it never went away. The trauma never went away.
Well, it just changes their perspective. Mm. The world is being a safe.
Well, you know, that's a great question in terms of what is safety. Because for a lot of the children with whom we work, they don't really understand what safety is, so they're still in that state that I was describing before. So, like, I'm going to ask everybody in here in a minute, I'm going to pick someone, I'm going to ask you to stand up, and I'll ask you a question relative to what Dan said earlier about neurology. I don't know who I'm going to pick yet, but... How do you feel? Yeah. I won't do that. I won't do it. So now how do you feel? Yeah. All right. So if you felt Like I just asked you, how you would feel if I was going to ask you to stand up in front of everybody and answer a question. If you felt like that all the time, I think that's what you're referring to, is that, you know, it's just, you're just always feeling that unsafe, I can't believe it. I'm going to be asked to do what life has not prepared me for, and I'm not ready. Not that they cognitively understand it that way, but that's how their body processes it, experiences, and that's what they live. So we live what we learn. If we learn that the world is not a safe place, we live that the world is not a safe place, and that's what our biology says. But if we don't start learning it, we never get past it. One way to help learn it is EEG biofeedback. That is a very concrete way of helping the body, helping the brain practice living in a less anxious state. It doesn't hurt. You're not putting anything into the body. The child is just watching a video game. As their body relaxes even a little bit, the video game goes faster. They get points. They get music, whatever. It's pleasing. So it's reinforcement. It's feedback. Short of that, or in conjunction with that, would be little exercises like this. To say, well, when it happened and it was over, what was the safety that you experienced, and help them learn what safety means. Because their body is feeling unsafe, but they may be safe. This is what parents tell me all the time. You know, this child has lived with me for 12 years, and he still tells me he knows that I'm going to give him up. How could that possibly be? I've told him. I've shown him. We've experienced it together. 12 years. Well, it's not because the parent didn't tell them enough. It's because they don't internalize safety. So you do have to do some cognitive work about what is safety, or some EMDR work about what is safety. How does that feel? And then I recommend doing EEG biofeedback, which I know is done here, to help a child feel what we're talking about. If I said to all the women in this room, okay, I want you to pretend that you're a man and feel what it's like, it would be difficult for us to do, I think, because we haven't been one. Same thing with you guys. If I said be a woman, it would be a little trickier. If you haven't ever felt safe, or at least not in your conscious memory, it's pretty hard to tell somebody feel safe. So we practice it in little ways, and we talk about it. Oh, that's what safety feels like. Wow, that's different from the way you usually feel. I'm curious, what is that like for you? So it's much bigger than five steps, and I get it with your questions. I understand that you're asking the right questions. You don't want to just jump in and do this. But T-A-N-T, learntant.org, or maybe .com, but it's learntant.com or org. Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. This came out just before as I was getting my things ready to come, and I was so intrigued by it that I decided to put it in here as something that we would want to look at. This is an example to me of how much we are now learning about watching the brain do things to give us information about what we can do therapeutically. I'm not real interested in pure science for the sake of pure science, but I am fascinated with what does that tell us about what we can do therapeutically. What can we do in a healing sense? How can we help people get better? Well, if we didn't know that the anterior cingulate cortex is hyperactive in people who are what we would call reoffenders or criminals, then we wouldn't have an idea of what we could do about it. So now we're getting this kind of very specific information, and we don't want to jump on it too soon because this may be part of a bigger brain picture. So we want to look at it in the context of what else is going on in the brain. But if we find out that this is something that we can address, wow, how fabulous to be in this era, this time of brain research that's giving us tools that help us understand how to help people get better and not live in the misery or terror that they've experienced for their lives. So did you want to ask a question, or it's just kind of an example?
Well, I guess the question I have, which probably jumps to it too quickly, is the study was done all on people who had offended?
Yes.
So it's not necessarily true that you could predict someone who hasn't
As far as I know, that was not, they were not included in this study. These are...
Well,
we probably all know that kid, right? Yeah. Yes, no, they were looking at people who were incarcerated, and then they did the study, and they looked at who came back, and then they did a correlation. But, and you know, there's always that big brother kind of thing that goes on with some of this, too, like, oh my gosh, what does it mean? We're going to just scan every kid in school and say, uh-oh, you're one. But there's a lot more to the picture, and I certainly would never use one thing like this to make a prediction on which we based something as awful as telling a kid, oh, you're an offender, or you're going to be. But it does give us more information about what parts of the brain are overactive, what we may need to be addressing, how else in the big picture the brain is changing, etc. So that's why I put it in there, just as an example. Okay, let's all take another deep breath, and I'm going to send around Hershey Kisses for... okay, for this third of the room. You don't want one, huh? Yeah. This third of the room. I love it. You're all going to get Hershey Kisses, and I'm going to hand them out. The middle of the room. No. You're all going to go to the back of the room and get a candy bar, I know. Bear with me here. Middle, and this side only. This is a thank you to you. Middle, no. And left side, I haven't decided yet. What's the rule, left side, for getting a Hershey Kiss? Do you want to just send some back?
Sure,
or could you? You looked ready.
Well.
Thank you. Left side of the room. What's the rule for getting a Hershey Kiss? What do you need to do to get one?
Be on the left side
of the room. What do you have to do? Be psychic. Sit down. Uh-huh.
Ask.
Maybe not do anything. Whine. Dan said whining is good. I like whining. Put your hands up. Is nobody knows what the rule is, right? So you could be standing on your head and spitting nickels, as my mother used to say, and I might still not give you one. You don't know what the rules are. These are where our children are. They don't know the rules. They'll tell you the rules when you teach them. They don't know them from the inside. They don't trust that they're true, and they don't believe that they're forever. So they may feel they'll do it one day and it might work. They'll do it the next day, it won't work. It's something that I worry about with our children, that they don't internalize the rules. It's not that they don't know them. So as a school principal, when the teachers used to come in and say to me, I can't believe it. Freddie had to be on the steps again at recess, and he knows the rule. Well, what's the rule, Freddie? The rule is you're not supposed to hit. I know. And he's telling us the rule, but he's telling us the rule. Brain that memorizes words, but it's not inside. So I just used this little example. Could you just pass these this way, but not in the middle?
Not in the middle.
Thank you, Barbara. Back and not in the middle. So see, if I change my mind now, I'm like a parent who gives a, you know, you're not going to get one, and then I change my mind. People in the middle, just because you've been so patient and waiting, you can take two while they're coming back. Here you go. So I don't give you one, I give you two. Being paradoxical is part of being a good parent and a good therapist for these children. Thank you, Hillary. And there are more up here, so I'll tell you what I'm going to do. Who's in the back who could take these for me and make sure everybody gets one? They sat in the wrong place, huh? This bag is going to go... Well, let me start it here. Can you just kind of wind it around? Or yeah, that would be great. Thank you. All right, so... this is another example of what we were talking about before, where you take a break. And what are we doing? We're internalizing. And remember when Dan said our gut is important. Our gut is tremendously important. So when I was in school to be a therapist, they told me you don't touch kids and you don't feed kids. Wrong. And that was really important to the people who taught me in graduate school. You don't touch kids and you don't feed kids. And somewhere I knew in my gut that that wasn't right. And so luckily for me, I just, you know, well, I was kind of oppositional anyway. So I did what I wanted to, but it was what I thought was right. And it is right. It is important to do it. But part of that is because what you're doing is helping a child internalize what you've been working on. So we did the trauma art narrative therapy. We talked a little bit about brain research, and I want you to internalize that with the Hershey Kiss. All right, so here's this little story. It was early in my career, and I was still not understanding fully the intent of parents being the most important person in the therapy room. So when this mom brought this little boy in, he was four. I'll call him Tony. It's not his name, but Tony had stopped taking a bath when he came home. His parents had divorced about a year before. Was at his dad's on the weekend, came home, and when she said, okay, it's bath time, he freaked and he wouldn't take a bath. And she said, oh, okay, all right, you don't have to. But then the next night it was the same thing, and the next night it was the same thing, so they came in. The first time that he was in, I didn't, of course, ask him, well, so, Tony, why aren't you taking a bath? Why are you freaking when there's bath water being run? But we did get to know each other a little bit. We used some of the stuffed animals. We just had a relaxed time so he could get to know me. His mom was in the room. The second time was very much the same thing. On the third time, I asked him to sit on my lap. He seemed a little more comfortable, and this is where I say I made a mistake, which I learned later. He should have been on his mom's lap, not mine. But regardless, he was on my lap, and you know that moment when you just know that what you're doing is just it? You're there. It's like teachers would call it the teachable moment. And they're looking right in your eyes, and he had the most beautiful blue eyes, and he was looking right up at me, and I was looking down at him, and I thought, okay, Lark, don't blow it. This is your moment. And as I was getting ready to ask him or to talk about what happened, he said to me, you have hair up your nose. And I tried very hard to keep a straight face, you know, and I said, yeah, you're right. And he said, why? And I said, I don't know, I guess God made me that way. And he said, oh, gross. And he then went on to tell me what happened and why he knew why they were there. It just poured right out. And what that taught me was they're going to test us every way they can to make sure that they're safe. Whatever they're going to tell us, we are not going to freak. We're not going to throw them away. We're not going to push them away. We're not going to tell them to shut up, don't talk about that, whatever. We're safe. So he insulted me the best way he could to see what my reaction would be, and I guess I passed. Well, I think of that story when we're talking about music therapy because I'm a pretty, I actually was a good musician when I was a kid, but, you know, I can't sing for anything, regardless of my name. So sometimes we do stuff in therapy that can be very embarrassing to us, and we have to just lump it if the kids make fun of us. But we have to put ourselves out there. So something I learned sitting in with a music therapist from several years ago. In fact, Ken, it's the woman from Florida that we were going to have a conference call. Music therapist. She showed me that, you know, you don't have to be an expert at something in order to gain a child's trust. But you do have to be ready to let them make fun of you or test you out to make sure that you're a safe person. So in music therapy, we're looking at six elements that are pretty universal. Rhythm, melody, harmony, timbre, dynamics, and format. And even though culturally music is different, there are these same structures everywhere you go. And this is Anna. This is was our music therapist before she moved to Florida. And this is her adopted son, Andy, although it was a while ago. And what she asked me to include what a music therapist would do as part of music therapy. Now, a story that I can tell you, and this is not about Andy, this was about a little boy from Mexico who was adopted from what they would call an orphanage. It was really a large cage outside where the kids were herded. Then they were let out during the day to run around and do what they wanted, and they scrounged for food in trash cans, and they did whatever. And a lot of the kids formed gangs, and this little boy and his brother were both adopted into Pennsylvania. The younger one was beaten blind, literally, by older kids, and there was a gang leader who was the one who beat this younger brother, and the older brother was not able to protect his brother. So the major problem that he came in with was the guilt over not protecting his younger brother. Traditional therapy, how the heck do you get to that? I mean, that's pretty profound. Anna started working with him, and the only way that he could express he didn't want to talk about what happened, who would? And in his life, his brother was still blind. So that never went away. So I was just going to say that was still staring him in the face, but that's a really bad pun. Every day he looked at his brother and he was reminded that he didn't protect him. So I think this is what you're talking about. Life has changed for this child, and he will never again be able to go back and correct what happened or change what happened. But Anna started working with him, and she was able to help this child express his feeling about the gang, and especially this one gang master, gang leader, by using the lower notes on a keyboard, pounding on them to make this sound. And her reaction was, oh, how scary, how overwhelming, how disempowering, whatever words she could give to this that resonated with this this boy, who was at the time about 9. So when I first saw this, I thought, holy mackerel, there's something here that's really much bigger than most of us can do. But in terms of there are 6 ways that we're all involved in music. And one of them is synchrony of brain. And this is where brain research, again, is coming out to show us something really profound. So everybody, if you would, just take a minute. Who's underneath us? Is there a room underneath? Okay, everybody just pound your feet like this for a minute. When you do this, you are synchronizing your brain. You're helping your brain come into a place where it's talking to itself in a way that is more productive. Thank you for doing that. Yeah. Simple, extremely helpful. Very important in therapy, profoundly. Not just stamping your feet, but other ways that you can get synchrony, and it may be beating on a drum, because when you beat on a drum, you're also part of the story, right? The story which comes out as the sound of drums. Now, this is Jamie's story, but there I watched then a gazillion of them, and it could be that they were expressing themselves through a song, like that Nora Jones song. They could tell a story through the song or through the melody or the harmony. And then good music therapist knows when a child is ready and then how to engage the child. And again, part of that is knowing that they can self-regulate. Because if you put a lot of our children on that drum, what's going to happen? The drum will get broken. Nothing good will come of it. They have to be able to self-regulate to a certain degree. Or you have to be confident that you can regulate them, because maybe they're not there yet. If they're a child who will stop when you say stop, even if they do it like 2 more times after you say stop, just to show you that they can, then it may be a good time to start music therapy. And I don't know, do you all, not you don't do music? I saw a guitar out here. Not a form. And maybe it didn't go so well. Oh, okay. Ooh. Yeah, I think. But in a formal setting, as a music therapist, and a good music therapist will be able to do a formal work with children, it can be really very, very helpful. So I know that we had originally said quarter of, and I understand that some people have to leave. But let's wrap up by this. Can you now, if you would, take a breath and go back to the beginning of our hour and a half? Given the stated objectives we had from this time together and yours, the ones that you had developed for yourself. can you think of some of the goals that we've met? We've practiced several different types of self-regulation activities which are easily used in a therapy session. We learned, or at least were exposed to, one particular kind of art therapy that I believe is not just important as a therapeutic tool in and of itself, but also as a way of helping the brain learn how to go through the process of relating and reducing the negative effects of trauma. We talked about two particular kinds of therapy, art and music therapy, that are very helpful to the brain processing that our children need to learn, and to the trauma therapy that they need to go through. And I've given you some resources, and I'm sorry we didn't get that last sheet. Oh, shucks. What is it? You think they're here?
They ran it off.
They did? Are they here? Did everybody get that last sheet? They're over here on the table. Thank you so much, whoever did that. I really appreciate it. So pick one up on your way out. But we've added a couple things to that, so don't forget those other resources. Okay, if anyone wants to stay, if they have a question, I'm happy to stay. But otherwise, before you walk out, let's everybody stand up together. Yeah, and a nice stretch. Feels good, doesn't it? Stretching and that deep breathing is also going to help you internalize what we talked about. Ooh, I love that. That's a good one. And thank you all for being here. I do have some books up here. I have my cards. Thank you.